Time is filled with swift transition. Not of earth and moon can stand. Build your hopes on things eternal. Hold to God's unchanging hand. Hold to his hand, to God's unchanging hand. Hold to his hand, to God's unchanging hand. Build your hopes on things eternal. Hold to God's unchanging hand. Trust in him who will not leave you. Whatsoever years may bring, if by earthly friends forsaken, still more closely to him cling. Hold to his hand, to God's unchanging hand. Hold to his hand, to God's unchanging hand. Build your hopes on things eternal. Hold to God's unchanging hand. When your journey is completed, if to God you have been true, fair and bright the home in glory, your enraptured soul will view. Unchanging hand. Hold to his hand, to God's unchanging hand. Build your hopes on things eternal. Hold to God's unchanging hand. Hold to his hand, to God's unchanging hand. Hold to his hand, to God's unchanging hand. Build your hopes on things eternal. Hold to God's unchanging hand.
Oh, bless. Once again, welcome to the online teaching worship of the Cross Tabernacle Church of Christ here in West Jordan, Utah. My name is Randy Clay. I'm the teaching minister here with the Cross Tabernacle Church, and we're just thrilled that you joined us today. We're in this series in Philippians called Defiant Joy. If this is your first time to be with us, the idea of defiant joy, and then he uses this word joy some 16 times here in these four short verses. Meaning, defiant is, I know what's going on in the world, but I have chosen, I made a decision that I'm going to have joy. Denial is, I don't want to know what's going on, I'm in my own private world, I'm ignoring the outside world. That's not what we're saying. We're saying, in these turbulent times, that Paul is teaching us something vital, that you and I make a decision to have joy. We're being defiant in that, because right now the world is trying its best just to knock us down, get us discouraged, get us distracted, get us really in this dark place, you know, and get us really down. And I know a lot of people now are fearful, just really full of fear, and they're fearful, and they're discouraged, and they're just really, you know, doubting their future. And so we're diving in these last few months to this theme of defiant joy and really unpacking this letter to the Philippians. And today we're in chapter 2, verses 12 and 13. And we're going to be talking about how to have a great workout, meaning a great spiritual workout. But we're going to use some parallels between having a physical workout and a spiritual workout. So let's dive in. Open your Bibles to the letter to the Philippians, chapter 2, verses 12 and 13. We'll just unpack these few verses today. And so, we start with this idea. I just heard this story, saw the video this past week of Kenneth Leverich. Later, you can check out this YouTube. It's this thing went viral, over 100 million views of this video. He went down to Venice Beach, to Muscle Beach. There's an area on the beach there where they have fenced off this area where bodybuilders, weightlifters can go and show off what they can do in their muscles. And so Kenneth went down and he challenged all these guys to a weightlifting contest. And he smoked them. I mean, he smoked them. What I didn't tell you was that he went disguised as an 84-year-old man. He had his cardigan on. He had his Dockers on. Great makeup. He went to Hollywood and got the best makeup possible because he knew that he had to be convincing. So he got the best makeup that he could find. I mean, the best makeup artist he could find. And he really looked the part. So he goes down there and he's lifting these weights and doing all these things. And I mean, the cameras are out. People are just amazed. They just can't believe. I mean, he goes down and he just shuffles down there, you know. And, hey, how you doing, kids? Can I get in on this? And they're like, hey, Pops, you know, take it easy. And he starts just doing all this crazy stuff. So at the end, they say, hey, you know, we can learn from you. How did you get this way? How can, you know? And he said, well, you know, just got to work out every day. Just get a little stronger every day. That's the whole secret. And I never knew in the video whether they found out who he was or not. I think they did. But let's take that to heart. Do what you do every day, and you'll get a little stronger every day. That was his exhortation to the weightlifters. Well, that's almost Paul's admonition to the Philippians. In America, we love our workouts. We love to work out. Even in this time of COVID, I know that a lot of them are closing in this time of COVID and the economy. But at their height, a few months ago, there were 36,080 health clubs, gyms around the country. 36,000. We spend $94 billion a year worldwide on workout gyms. Now think about that. $94 billion. We have 340,000 personal trainers. 340,000. And they will tailor make a workout just to fit you. Your health, your current health, your background, your age, your what, I mean, they'll factor all that stuff in and create a workout plan catered just for you. And so 58 million Americans use these gyms on a regular basis. 58 million. Now here's a stat for you. Let's say you get a gym membership. 80% will quit in 5 months. 80%. Why? Because it's hard and it hurts. It's hard and it hurts. So these gyms are important to a lot of us. I love this quote by Chesterton. Christianity has not been tried and found wanting. It has been found difficult and not tried. So Paul writes to the Philippians. This is what he says. Therefore, my dear friends, as you have always obeyed, not only my presence, but now much more in my absence, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you to will and to act in order to fulfill his good purpose. Paul's encouraging him to work out what? Their salvation. Now many have said that this verse really encourages salvation by works, and that we work to earn our salvation. Nothing could be further from the truth as we unpack this verse. I think that's going to become very clear what Paul is really saying. He's not saying that. He's saying just the opposite, in effect. So let's unpack this verse for a few minutes, these couple of verses. He says, therefore, as we had talked about last week, that word is a connector. It's a word of, because of the consequence of, this is what I want you to do, based on what I've just said. So it goes back again to verses 5 through 11. Based on what Christ has already done, based on the template of Christ and how he lived, Paul says, therefore, my dear friends, based on what Christ has done, based on that template, my dear friends, now here's what you should do. Here's how you apply the life of Christ to what. So it's all based on what Christ has done. And so Paul says, as you have always obeyed, not only in my presence, but now much more in my absence, continue to work out your salvation. And so Paul's point is simply this. You are working out what God has already worked in. You are simply working out, you're showing the world what God has already done in you. But he says that in verse 13. We'll get to that here in just a second. And so he says, therefore, my dear friends, as you have always obeyed, he's bragging on the Philippians. Now he said, Philippians, I know that you have always obeyed. You're just not churchgoers. You are sold out disciples. You are walking with Christ. You are obeying him on a daily basis. Now Paul's in prison. Now Paul's not around to come, because Paul wanted to come see them again. But he can't. And he can't be with them physically. So Paul says, as you have always obeyed, he's encouraging them, as you have always obeyed, not only in my presence while I was there, but how much more in my absence. Paul says, although I'm not there, obey as if I were there, as you always have been doing. Do you know people at your work who work differently when the boss is around or the supervisor comes around, or they're watching you work or you're watching and they work differently than when the boss is not there? But Paul addresses this over in Colossians when he says, you know, don't just work because your earthly masters are watching you. And when their eye is on you, work as if the Lord is watching you, because he is. Work for the Lord, not for men. So for that reason, because you're working for the Lord, you work the same, whether their eye is on you or not. Parents, how many times have you left instructions for your children? And you say, all right, I want you kids to act as if we were here. And perhaps you leave them some instructions. Clean your room, do your homework, then you can watch TV. And parents, how'd you feel when you came home and they had cleaned the room? The babysitter said they were great. They cleaned their room, then they did their homework, and they did exactly what you told them to do. Parents, how'd you feel?
Man, yes.
Yeah, we're great parents. But many times you came home and it wasn't that way, right? Because you were gone, they kind of took advantage of the situation and they didn't act as if you were there, and they got distracted and the rooms weren't clean, homework was kind of done. So Paul says, as a parent, as a spiritual parent, he says, act as if I wasn't there, because Christ is with you. The Holy Spirit is living in you. God is with you. God is in you. God is with you. God is there. Jesus is there with you. Act on the basis of that you have the template of Christ. You know how to act. You know how to obey the gospel. So here's the real test of spiritual maturity. The real test is how you live when the audience is gone. How you live. How you act. How you treat others. What's your language like when you're by yourself? What you watch on TV? What you watch on your computer? There's no one else watching. Are you walking in your neighborhood? You're at work. No one else knows you're a believer. That's a real test of spiritual maturity. Who you are in that moment. Paul says that's the test of who you are when no one is watching, when the props are gone, the audience has dissipated, they're gone. Who are you in that moment? You might want to stop even the video and think about that and the implications of being this test of spiritual mature, of who am I when no one else is around, no one's watching. And so Paul exhorts them. How much more in my absence continue? Paul says, continue. I'm in jail. I'm in prison. Continue. Let me ask you today. Let me ask you a few questions. Based on this word, this exhortation of Paul, this telling them to continue. Continue. Keep on. Today, if you're doing great, your job's going well, your marriage is going well, your kids are great, you're all healthy, continue to walk with God. But today you might be unemployed. Maybe you just furloughed. And your kids are not feeling well. They're not getting along. Your marriage is struggling. Continue. Continue to walk with Christ. Continue to pray. Continue to fellowship with His people. Study God's Word. Press in. Maybe today you're discouraged. Continue. Maybe today you have more questions than you do answers. Continue. Maybe today your clouds above your head are a little dark and you don't know what the future holds for your job or for your health. Continue. Press in to God. So Paul encourages him, continue. I would encourage you today, continue. Continue to do what? Paul says, continue to work out your salvation with fear and with trembling. This idea of working out. What does Paul mean there? The word in Greek is one word. It means to give all your energy to bring something to completion. That's the idea, to bring energy to complete something you started. Let's give a few examples, maybe to get a handle on them. And all of these will have their limitations, but I think this will help you to understand it. Let's say that your parents left you a silver mine. And this is in Park City. I was thinking of Park City. In Park City, just about 30 miles east of Utah, is a city. It's called Park City. And it was founded by a silver mine silver miners, and a lot of money was made in Park City. So let's say that you're one of those families in Park City, Utah, and your family gave you a silver mine. Well, if you sat outside the silver mine and saying, I want the silver to walk out and come to me and just jump in my lap, doesn't happen that way. You've got to go in with your tools, pick and shovel, and you've got to, you know, chisel away at the walls of that mine, and you have to get the silver. You have to work it out. You didn't create the silver mine. You didn't buy the silver mine, but it's your energy that's bringing it to concert with your parents giving it. You work it out. Well, let's say you're a farmer and you have this field, and on its own the field may produce a little bit of produce, but you go out and you plant, you plow, then you plant and you fertilize and you water and you tend and you pull weeds and you work it out. You bring your energy to fruition, to the project. I'll say you're a musician and a composer gives you a composition. The composer has worked out the notes and the timing and the syncopation and the fortes and the crescendos and the harmony and the score. He gets it to you and says, play it, apply it. And you take it and you bring your talents to the table and you play the piece. You worked it out. You brought, but you didn't create the piece. You didn't, but you just used what was created to play the part. Honestly, you go to the doctor and he gives you an exam and says, hey, man, you're a mess. You need surgery. And so the doctor performs surgery. And you go to follow up and he says, you need rehab. You need to go once a week or twice a week for a couple of months. You need to take this medicine. You need to get on this diet. And you do, and you get healthy. Well, the doctor brought his expertise to the situation. And all you did was follow what he told you to do. And so I love this idea, is that spiritual maturity is human cooperation with God's operation. So God's done all the work. God's done the prescribing. God's done the spiritual surgery on us in baptism. And in grace, he's given us the Holy Spirit, put the Holy Spirit inside us. So spiritual maturity is our cooperation with what God's operation has already done on us. We're working it out. It is a representation of what's gone inside us. Now we're working it out in our lives. So Paul says, continue to work out yourself. So I love this idea and how it's worded in the New Living Translation. Dear friends, you always followed my instructions when I was with you. And now that I'm away, it is even more important. Work hard to show the results of your salvation. I love that phrasing. Work hard to show the results of your salvation, obeying God with deep reverence and fear. I put the word awe in there. It's not I'm scared to death that God is. I'm so in awe of God. I'm so deeply, deeply, deeply respecting. And I'm in deep, I just reverence him as God, as holy. And I'm in a really good fear and awe of him. For God is working in you, giving you the desire and the power to do what pleases him. Now let's get back to this idea. People say, well, this is work salvation. This is what Paul's teaching. But then they're not reading verse 13. So this is what Paul says. For it is God who works in you. It's God doing the stirring and the working. How? By the Holy Spirit. We don't have time right now to go into it, but think of the Holy Spirit, what the Holy Spirit does in you. the gift that we receive in baptism, Paul says, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit teaches us all truth. He guides us. He leads us. He convicts us of sin. If you take our First Steps class, we go into great detail about what the Holy Spirit's role in our lives as believers. And keep this in mind, that Paul is not talking to unbelievers and telling them how to be saved. Paul is talking to believers. He's talking to people who have already confessed Christ. They put their faith in Him. They've reenacted the death, burial, and resurrection. They're living as disciples. And so that's why it's even more important to understand the context of this verse. That Paul is telling believers to continue in their walk with Christ. You know, that there's a lot of things that's said that, you know, but the Bible never says lounge in the Spirit. The Bible never says, hey, veg in the Spirit. The Bible says walk in the Spirit. There's some action there, right? There's some energy that we're using to walk with God. We're using our intellect. We love God, and so we walk with Him, and we do the things that He's commanded. Part of the Great Commission is, and then after you baptize them, teach them to observe, to obey everything I've commanded. So that's our heartbeat. So we recognize that it's God that's working in us. We're not doing the work. God's already done all the work. We're simply applying our salvation. We're applying our lives and working out our salvation. As John exhorts us to do good deeds so that people can see who God is, that before men, that they know that we're salt and light, and that we do good works in order for people to praise God, not to praise us. And so, it is God working in you. You are working out what God has already worked in, right? And so this energy, I love this metaphor, this idea, this might help you as we close our thoughts today. It should be this. You've gone to an airport and you're late for your flight. No one, right? And you don't know if you're going to make it to the gate on time. Well, they have these magnificent things. A lot of airports have these things. I think they're called people movers, or they're like escalators, but they're no stairs there. But you can get on them, you can walk, and you can even run, and they'll move you along faster down, and you make your gate just in time. Well, without those people movers, you wouldn't have made it. You'd have been dead in the water. So it's like Paul saying God is. God moves us. God moves us along, and God gets us to where we're going, and we rely on God to get us to where we're going. On our own, we wouldn't make the gate. On our own, we wouldn't have the energy to get there. We wouldn't have the stamina. We wouldn't have the God does. And so, once again, as we look at this verse, and we just touched the surface of these two verses, we could have unpacked it even further, and we may still do it next week. Haven't decided yet what God's going to lead us to do. But let's read this verse again in its context. Now, I want you to know, therefore, my dear brothers, as you have always obeyed, not only in my presence, but now how much more in my absence. Remember, the true test of spiritual maturity is how you act when the audience is gone. Continue to work out your salvation, because we're working out what God has already worked in us. Your salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you to will and to act according to His good purpose. God's going to get you to the gate. Trust Him. But the key word today is continue. Continue to walk with God. Continue to trust Him. Continue to pray. Maybe you're not getting any answers. Press in. Continue to pray. I don't understand a lot of God's word. Continue to study. Continue to dig in. I'm discouraged. Continue. Trust. Hold God's hand. Things aren't going real well for me right now. Press in to God. Continue. Well, I hope this has been helpful. If we can help you in any way, we'd love to pray for you. Please leave a comment on how we can pray for you in the comment section. We have an electronic card. Please fill it out and let us know you're watching. Let us know how we can help you. If you live in the West Jordan area, we'd love for you to come and worship with us. The English service beginning next week is going to be back in the building at 9 o'clock. The Spanish service at 10:30. Our recorded service is at 10 a.m. And then our Zoom class is at 11. We'd love for you to join us. And our small groups meet throughout the week. Some are on Zoom. Some are live. See our website. But speaking of our website, go check out our website. On the bottom page, on the bottom of our title page, we have now new buttons to go to sermons, to go to Facebook, to go to our live stream, all kinds of neat little things there that you can just press one button and get to where you want to go. So our communications team has worked hard on our website. So I hope today's been helpful, but we'd love to study with you. We'd love to pray with you. We'd love to sit down and talk about the gospel with you, who Jesus was, who God was. Don't forget to take our First Steps course. It'll be up really soon. We have them all filmed. We're editing, and so very soon you can go online and take our First Steps class. And now we're filming our Next Steps. And so on how to dig in and dig deep to be a disciple and your first days and what a disciple is and what disciples do. And it's a great class. And so that's going to be filming this next week. So a lot of good things coming up. We want to just help you and be helpful in your walk with Christ, help you begin your walk with Christ. And so if we can just help you in any way possible, please let us know. This week, put in a good word for God. God loves you more than you can ever imagine. We're here to help you, connect you with God. That's why we're here, is to connect you and God. We'll get out of the way and let God do his thing, because God loves you and God will do a work in your life. And let God work in you. Let God forgive and give you his grace and put his arms around you and just tell you that you're loved. Because God does love you so much that he sent his one and only son to die for you on the cross. And so we love you. And we care for you. We care for you spiritually. We care for you emotionally. We care for you spiritually. We care for you economically. So let us know if there's any way that this church can serve you, whether you're a member here or not. So hope today's been helpful. Hope it's been challenging. Let's end today with a word of prayer. Father, thank you for today. Father, I pray that we'll all continue to work out our salvation with fear and trembling. Father, that we'll look to you. Father, but thank you for what you've already done in us. You've cleansed us. You've forgiven us. You've adopted us. You've called us your daughters and sons. And Father, you've put the Holy Spirit inside of us, that we're now living temples of your Holy Spirit. So, Father, thank you. And, Father, when we get discouraged, let's continue. Father, this week, let's continue to walk with you financially. Let's walk with you emotionally. Let's walk with you spiritually. Let's walk with you relationally. Father, let's just continue to walk with you in every way we can. So, Father, thank you for loving us. Father, thank you for being the God who sends his one and only Son to die for us. So, Father, I just pray that you just give us the strength and the help this week as we walk with you once again. Father, we ask it in your Son's name. And everybody said, amen. Awesome. Hey, thanks for joining us. Hope you find it helpful, maybe a little challenging. But hope you found it just so encouraging that today that we're all going to continue. Let us know once again how we can help you continue or begin your walk with Christ. We'll see you next week. God bless.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand, in Christ alone, who took on flesh he came to save, till on that cross as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied, for every sin on him was laid. Here in the death of Christ I live, there in the ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain, then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again, and as he stands for victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me, from life's first cry to final breath. Jesus commands my destiny, no power of hell, no scheme of man can ever block me from his hand, till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I stand.
Well, good afternoon. Maybe it's afternoon for you. As we prepare our minds for the Lord's Supper today, I wanted to ask the question, why? I'm sure a lot of you are asking the same question, especially with what we're going through right now. Why is this happening to us? Why are we going through this? Why don't we have a cure? Why don't we have more answers? You know, in our society and today, we think we need to have answers to all the questions we have immediately. Well, I'm sure if we think of Jesus when he was instituting the Lord's Supper, do you not think that the disciples had the same questions? Why? Why is he doing this? What are we doing? How come? Why can't we have answers? You know, I think we maybe are not understanding just how things changed when Jesus implemented the Lord's Supper. We're talking about the Passover in a totally different way. So I think we need to maybe look at that before we start spending too much time worrying about why and expecting we have answers right now. We see what happened when Jesus changed the Lord's Supper. I want to start reading out of Luke 22, starting with verse 14. When the hour had came, Jesus and his disciples reclined at the table, and he said to them, I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it again until it finds fulfillment in the kingdom of God. You can bet the disciples were looking at each other going, what? Why is he saying this? What does it mean? And then he went on, and he says, he took the cup, and he gave it thanks to for the cup. And he said, take this and divide it among you. For I tell you, I will not drink again from this fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. I'm sure they were all saying, why? Why is he saying this? What does it mean? How can this be? We're seeing Jesus ask them to take the Lord's Supper and to partake of this Last Supper in a different way. At that time, they didn't understand it. I'm sure that the question why is going all around. Then he said, he took the bread and gave thanks, and broke it and gave it to them and said, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Why? Why should we do this in remembrance of you? The questions had to be really going strong around the table. And finally, in the same way, after the supper, he took the cup. This is in Luke 22:20. This is the cup, he says, the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. Boy, you can bet the questions flew then. Why is he doing this? We do not understand this. But we all know now, 2,000 years later, even directly after this, not too long after this, the importance of what was established at this time. I think it's important for us to see just how great and wonderful God is, and that we need to maybe not ask so many questions of why, but put our trust in him and know that in good time, our questions will be answered. Know that it is for our good. Know that God loves us and he cares for us so much, just as he did for the disciples. And of course, later on, that whole evening, Jesus went, you know, in the garden, and where he was arrested, you can bet. The question why? Why was this happening? What is going on? Just continued on through this whole ordeal. But so I want you to maybe just understand that when we start talking about asking the question why. At this time, Jesus wants us to focus on him. Why? Because he is our Savior. Because he saved us through his blood, through the atonement, through his death, burial, and resurrection. That is why he is our Savior, and that's why we need to put our trust in him. Let's go ahead and have a prayer. Most righteous and eternal Father in heaven, we come to you at this time and want to thank you for this opportunity we have to remember our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Why? Because he died for our sins. Because he loves us. Because he chose us as his heirs. And we just thank you so much, dear Father, that we can take this time to take this cup and this bread and remember the things, all the things that Jesus have done for us and all of the questions that we have answered through this, that have been answered through the years. And help us, dear Father, to be patient, to be understanding, to know that you have all things in control. It's in Christ's name we do pray. Amen.
Some glad morning when this life is o'er, fly away, to a home on God's celestial shore. Life are grown, I'll fly away, like a bird from prison bars has flown. Shall never end.